This is Ian Cameron for Sportsbook Review with your NFL Week 2 betting preview as we highlight several of the marquee matchups taking place in Week 2 action. Let's get our rundown started with a look at the Kansas City Chiefs taking on the Houston Texans, a battle of 1-0 teams, although it didn't look like for a long time last week that Kansas City was going to be 1-0 after their first game. Just an incredible comeback slash San Diego collapse last week for the Chiefs. Let's give them credit. I mean, they came back, they didn't quit on that game, but let's be honest, at the same time, we have to admit that game really changed on a dime the moment Keenan Allen got hurt for the San Diego Chargers. That offense stopped working really in that game from the moment Keenan Allen went down with that ACL injury. And the Chiefs, you know, made some things happen. Alex Smith finally got things going offensively. Spencer Ware at running back, filling in for Jamaal Charles, made some plays running the football. Chiefs did a great job. Their defense started to get stops, although I thought the Chargers really got way too conservative with the big lead. They stopped trying to take shots down the field. I know Allen was out, but I think Mike McCoy and that Chargers coaching staff a little bit guilty of just trying to run the clock out, and they ended up paying the ultimate price for it. Chiefs come all the way back to win. Got to be a little bit concerned about the spot here for Kansas City. Off that big emotional win, now you're going on the road to face the Texans. And it's a Texans team that absolutely should be fired up for this game. The Houston Texans looking to make amends following an absolutely disappointing playoff loss to the Chiefs last year. Playoff revenge here for the Houston Texans. Ain't Brian Hoyer at quarterback in this game for the Texans, and I'm sure they're pretty thankful that's not the case. Brock Osweiler wasn't perfect last week, but was solid in his debut. 22 of 35, 231 yards passing, 2 touchdowns, 1 interception. I think the impressive part was Lamar Miller running the football, 106 yards on the ground. They were definitely looking for good production from him, bringing him on board, and they were able to get that. This is an interesting game. I'm not sold on laying it with Houston here. They've still got to prove to me they're the better team. And look at Kansas City. I mean, they could have packed that game in last week, but boy, they didn't, and they came back to win. They could be a little bit of a letdown here for the Chiefs, but I just don't think the price is great here with Kansas City as an underdog. They still could end up being the better of these two teams in the end. So I'm not backing the Chiefs here, but not looking to make a case for Houston laying the points here at home either. Miami-New England next up in our NFL Week 2 rundown. This should be an interesting matchup here because the Miami Dolphins, a wire-to-wire point spread winner last week against Seattle, double-digit underdogs. They were right in that game. They were live to win that game right till the end. Took the lead in the fourth quarter, and then Russell Wilson and the Seahawks offense, which hadn't done anything in that game prior to late in the fourth quarter, finally got a drive to stick the ball in the end zone and give Seattle a narrow victory. But I was very impressed with the Miami defense. That defensive line, there is no reason they can't be a disruptor this year and be a force, and one of the better defensive lines, if you ask me, in the NFL. I mean, led by Ndamukong Suh. We know when he's got his head on straight and he's mentally clicked into the game, he can be one of the best D linemen in football. We know Cameron Wake is healthy again. From a pass rush perspective, that's going to help this Miami Dolphins team for sure. And you got to be a little bit concerned about the cluster injuries on the offensive line for New England. We saw Jimmy Garoppolo last week in a very, very great good performance, in my opinion, against Arizona, considering no Gronk. A battered offensive line. He still made big-time plays, showed poise, made winning plays when he had to, but he's going to be tested by this Miami defensive front. There's no telling if Nate Solder or Jonathan Cooper along that O-line are going to be healthy enough to play in this game, and if they don't, it's going to be a little bit of a concern here for the Patriots in terms of their O-line against this very, very impressive-looking Miami defensive front, which completely dominated in the trenches over Seattle and their offensive line last week. So, you know, I thought New England had a ton of value last week, +9.5, +10 almost by kickoff against Arizona. They didn't even need all the points. They won outright. I'd be a little bit careful laying close to a touchdown with New England here. I'm not sure this is a great matchup with their banged-up O-line against Miami's defensive front. It's going to be a question of can Ryan Tannehill and the Dolphins' offense play better, because they really didn't move the football much at all against Seattle last week. But if they can punch in, you know, a touchdown or two at least this week against New England's defense, Miami might be able to hang around. I'd certainly be more interested in the underdog underdog here than I would laying it with the favorite. Let's move on now in this game, in this NFL Week 2 rundown. Cincinnati and Pittsburgh. Steelers off an impressive Monday night win against Washington. On both sides of the football, they played very, very well in that game. I was very impressed. And you got to be concerned with the spot for the Steelers, no question. Monday night, now you're playing on a short week on Sunday. But they'll be up for this game. It's a rivalry. We know the bad blood between these two teams. The Bengals and Steelers do not like each other, and that's an understatement. And I've got concerns still after last week's performance by the Bengals, even in a victory. You know, defensively, they still gave up some plays to the Jets, running the football and throwing it. And their offensive line, you know, was very, very much under siege in that game. I mean, the Jets notched several sacks on Andy Dalton. And I have concerns about this Cincinnati offense overall. I mean, they lose Hugh Jackson, a great offensive coordinator. Can they be just as productive this season? I'm still not so sure. Pittsburgh's defense really impressed last week. I mean, Washington's offense, and Kirk Cousins specifically at home, had played very well in his career. Pittsburgh's defense played very well last week. I was impressed with that unit. We'll see if they can get the same pressure on Dalton and that Bengal offensive line that the Jets were able to apply last week in that game. You know, it's another game where we're looking at playoff revenge here. That fourth quarter meltdown by the Cincinnati Bengals in the postseason against Pittsburgh last year. You know they want this one, but I don't know if the price is right to back the Bengals here. I still think Pittsburgh's the better team. I know they're playing on a short week, but they're only laying a field goal at home. I think from a value perspective, value's on the Steelers, and we're going to come back to this game for play of the week time at the end of this video. Let's go back. Let's continue to look at week two. Next up, Tampa Bay, Arizona. A late game, 4:05 Eastern kickoff on Sunday. I have some major concerns with Arizona. This is now not just a funk now. This is a big-time slump that they're in since last season. I mean, they didn't play good against Green Bay in the playoffs. Lucky to win that game, if you ask me. They got absolutely ambushed by the Carolina Panthers in the NFC Championship game. That wasn't good. They get absolutely, really blindsided by New England here last week. I mean, didn't play well. Scattershot offensively. Carson Palmer made some big plays to Larry Fitzgerald, but he also made some bad throws. They didn't have a great amount of protection at times for Palmer along that Arizona offensive line. And that defense, you know, Jimmy Garoppolo, first ever start on the road against what's supposed to be a Super Bowl caliber team. He had no problem moving the football for extended stretches against that Arizona defense. So there's concerns. There's quotes in the media saying the players are sort of insinuating they got a little bit outcoached in that loss to New England last week. Some bad signs, bad locker room vibes from Arizona. Tampa Bay, though, this is going to be a step up in class. I understand that. Second straight road game. This is a big-time upgrade in terms of competition when you go from the Atlanta Falcons to Tampa Bay here. But they were still impressive last week, Tampa Bay. We can't take anything away from them. Jameis Winston looked great in the passing game. The offense moved the football. The defense, yeah, they gave up some plays, but they really tightened things up when they had to with the game on the line, and they were able to get a nice win against Atlanta on the road last week. I am a little bit concerned with the second road game in as many weeks spot here for the Bucs, but still think this team is on the rise. I think they're going to be a money-making team. We used Tampa Bay as our play of the week winner last week against the Atlanta Falcons, and it wouldn't surprise me to see Tampa Bay make a game of this. It really wouldn't. Arizona is going to obviously be a little bit desperate here. A little concerning that, you know, if they have their A game, can Tampa Bay be able to match it? But I'm not interested in the favorite. I've got a lot of red flags right now with Arizona. It's Tampa Bay or nothing for me in this game. Indy and Denver taking place on Sunday afternoon in the late game window at 4:25 Eastern. Indy is a dead nuts over team right now as far as I'm concerned. They've got the quarterback in Andrew Luck. They've got just absolute a decimated secondary injury-wise. Vontae Davis and company, Darius Butler, you go on down the list. There's just everybody banged up in this Colts secondary. Now the question is Denver's offense capable of taking advantage of it the way the Detroit Lions took advantage of it last week, that Colts secondary? Can Trevor Siemian make plays in the passing game? You know they're going to rely on C.J. Anderson running the football in that Denver defense, but can he make enough plays in the passing game against that secondary? That's going to be the question mark. I thought he played well all right last week, Simeon. I still think he can play better. There were a couple balls he missed. He was overthrew a couple receivers, you know, threw some balls into the turf as well at times. I think he's still got to develop better consistency, but decent first start against a very good Carolina team for the Denver Broncos. I was against Indy last week. I wouldn't be totally against going against them here once again. However, Colts have been a very good road underdog in recent years. That would be the one concern. I'm not sure the value is all that great. I'd still lean Denver minus six here. Also lean over the total. But boy, this total's really been hammered up. It opened 44. It's up to 46.5. Signs that it might even go to 47. So lean Denver, lean over, but probably will just remain in the lean category for me in that game. Sunday Night Football, Green Bay taking on Minnesota. I know there's question marks with Minnesota at quarterback. Sam Bradford, from all reports, is going to get his first start with the Vikings, replacing Sean Hill. And if anyone wants a week, it may not be difficult to understand why. The Vikings now are ready to go with Sam Bradford. I'm not saying he's going to be a huge, huge upgrade, considering he's still new to the team, still learning this offense, but you know they're not going to put him in a position where he's going to have to do too much. I think he's still a guy that can do things and be able to be a capable job here in his first start with the Minnesota Vikings. On the flip side, Aaron Rodgers and the Packers offense didn't exactly light it up against Jacksonville on the road last week. They had some good moments, but they didn't have a consistent, steady, you know, offensive showing last week in that first game. You know, and this, don't undersell what this game means to the Minnesota Vikings. They lost twice to the Packers last year and really didn't play well in either game. Now they've got Green Bay at home, the first ever game at their brand new US Bank Stadium, which apparently is going to be the loudest stadium in the NFL this season. This is a circle spot for the Minnesota Vikings if I've ever seen one. And even though I've got big-time issues, you better believe I've got big-time concerns about how good Sam Bradford can play, it's not like they're going to ask him to do too much. Rely on your offensive line. Rely on your receivers. Rely on Adrian Peterson, one of the best running backs in the NFL, and rely on a Super Bowl-caliber defense, one of the best defenses in the NFL, who scored multiple times defensive touchdowns last week in the win against Tennessee. Just don't make critical mistakes. Protect the football. Be conservative. Let the rest of the team around you help you to victory. And I think the rest of the team around Sam Bradford is good enough to help Minnesota to victory in this spot. I'm not interested in laying it with Green Bay on the road here. Vikings are pass for me on the Sunday nighter. Monday night, to wrap up our video, Philadelphia Eagles, Chicago Bears. And boy, this is going to be one of those games where a lot of people are going to be saying, wow, what a job Carson Wentz did in his Eagles debut against the Cleveland Browns. But hold on now. He did that against the Cleveland Browns. We have to keep that in mind. Now you're on the road. You're facing a Chicago Bears team that actually played somewhat respectable defensively last week, even in the loss against the Texans. I need to see Carson Wentz do it on the road against a better team before I endorse the Philadelphia Eagles in this price range. The question is, on the flip side, do you trust the Bears laying a field goal? Do you trust Jay Cutler, who again had some decent moments last week, but also some critical interceptions at bad times? That's what you get from Jay Cutler, and that's going to be the interesting thing. And the Eagles defense did play well against it was a terrible Browns offense, so you have to take that with a grain of salt. But Jim Schwartz's defense for Philadelphia did play very well last week. That being said, if I'm playing it at minus three or lower, I can only look to the Chicago side. I think the value's with them. I need to see Wentz be able to play well on the road before I trust him in a price range where he's almost got to win the game in order to cover the number. So lean Bears on the Monday nighter. All right, let's wrap it up. NFL Week 2, play of the week time. We're going back to the Bengals-Steelers game. I'm laying the three with Pittsburgh here. I know it's a short week for the Steelers, but it's a cheap price with what I think is right up there with New England as the best team in the AFC on paper. Minus three, about minus 120 is what you can get. You can get minus three, minus 120 at bookmaker/Chris at Five Dimes, among others at The Greek. That's Pittsburgh, rotation number 270, minus three over Cincinnati, your NFL Week 2 play of the week.
Always on the go? Bet365 has one of the top mobile platforms in today's market. Sign up today and don't let your busy life keep you out of the game.